H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Now, in today's class, we are going to start with the virtual user generator. Okay. The first topic that we are going to discuss is protocols. Okay. Here, the general definition of FIF protocol is simply a protocol means set of rules. Okay. A protocol means a general definition for a protocol is set of rules. And here, let me say set of rules for proper communication. Okay. Say for example here, if you want to have a healthy communication between you and me, we will be having a proper communication, right? Well, say when you join, probably we say hi, I may say hello. It's a kind of a proper communication. Say you may ask something like, say when did you going to share the class transcript? And for that question, I will properly reply that probably in 1 or 2 days I will share. Okay, and say you may ask one question like, when are you going to share videos? Again, I may say that probably in any day I'm going to share. So here we have some kind of a proper communication. You are asking something and I'm replying accordingly. Say for example, you are asking for material, class transcript. So I said that, no, we don't have a class. So do we have any relation for that? You are asked something and I'm saying something else. So it means we have a communication, but we don't have a proper communication. Okay. So in simple terms, a protocol means a set of rules for proper communication. So each type of application has its own communication. Okay. Generally, the communication between client and server is called as a protocol here. Okay. Now, for example, here in our machine, a browser, I can call it as a client. Okay. A browser, I can call it as a client. And say here, I'm trying to open a Facebook, or if I'm trying to open some Amazon. Okay. Now here, this browser, whatever the browser that we have here, is called as a client. And here, I'm accessing Amazon. And if I search something here, basically, server is responding, right? So here we have a proper communication from our browser to the server. Say here I'm searching for something here. Okay, if I enter something camera here and if I click on go, and here we are going to get the results based on the camera, right? Whatever here we have entered, it is showing the results accordingly here. It means our server is understood what exactly we are requesting. Okay, we requested that I want the results for camera. So server has responded accordingly. It means from this browser we have a proper communication with the Amazon server over here. Now here I'm saying that client and server. So here in our case, when a browser is basically a client, and here Amazon server is the server. So we are requesting. Say the first request that we have done is, we wanted to open Amazon.com. So we send this request to the server over here. Okay, and server is accordingly replied. It understood this request, and it is being replied with the Amazon homepage. Okay. So here from the client, from the browser, initially here we have mentioned Amazon.com. Okay, here we typed it. Okay, so here we are mentioning this Amazon. When you click enter over here, basically this request send to the server. Okay, server understand that, okay, he is requesting for Amazon homepage. So server is going to respond accordingly. Now this is server is giving this particular page. Okay, some server is down, or say some network is down. Are we going to get this page? No, right, we are going to get some kind of a blank page or some server not found, some page we would have get. It means server has responded properly over here. So we send, from this browser, we send a request saying that www.amazon.com, and Amazon server understood this particular request and it is responded accordingly over here. Okay. Now similarly, say here from the browser, I entered some camera, and again I send it to the request over here, and the Amazon server accordingly responded, and it has been given the camera result, appropriate results over here, right? Okay, this Amazon server has been responded with appropriate results over here. So here, so this is called as a communication over here. Okay, 1 minute. Okay, so here 1 minute. Okay, so from the browser we send this request and server is responded accordingly, and again from this browser we send something and it has been responded accordingly. So this is the proper communication between client and server, and here the client is nothing but our browser and server is Amazon.com. Basically, this communication technically we call it as a HTTP communication or HTML communication, because here it is a web-based application. Because it is a web-based application, this communication is called as HTTP HTML communication. Okay, so in other words, we call it as a HTTP HTML protocol. Okay, the communication, the set of rules that are applying between this browser and the server is HTTP HTML protocol. Now, in a similar way, say for example, if you are working on SAP application, but basically SAP application, there will be something called SAP GUI. SAP GUI would be installed on our machine. Okay, there will be something called SAP GUI which will be installed on our machine. Okay, our SAP solution manager, we will be having something called SAP solution manager. Okay, as part of SAP solution manager, SAP GUI will be installed, and this is nothing but this will acts like a client. This SAP GUI will act like a server, client, and there will be some SAP related server. Some hub will be there. Okay, again, whatever you do in this SAP GUI, whatever the transactions, whatever you do in this SAP GUI, basically it depends on this SAP server. Okay, so basically again, there will be some communication will happen between this SAP GUI to the SAP server. Okay, so this particular communication will be called as SAP GUI protocol. So like this, based on the application type, you have a different protocols. So you have a HTTP or HTML protocol. This is a widest protocol that we are going to use. Most of the times we do performance testing mainly for the web-based applications. Okay, because basically web-based applications are only will be used by a huge volume of users, right? Generally, a web application is going to be used by most number of people. That is where a performance testing is mandatory, and it is required to test the application. Okay, most of the times we use HTTP HTML protocol. However, we are also having SAP web protocol. It means there will be exclusive SAP web applications also there. Here I was talking about SAP GUI, right? Similarly, there is something called SAP web. So if you are trying to find the performance of an SAP web application, you are going to use SAP web protocol. Okay, and similarly, SAP GUI. And terminal emulator protocol. Again, this is this terminal emulator is mainly for the mainframe applications. Okay, and the SQL protocol, Oracle again in Oracle two tier, three tier, and Oracle NCA. Based on the type of the version, I mean based on the version of the Oracle, we'll have a different protocols over here. Okay, so these are the different protocols that are available here in LoadUnder. I mean particularly in Virtual User Generator, these are the protocols available. Okay, so based on the type of application you are going to use, based on the type of the application that you are going to work, you are going to choose the protocol over here. Okay, and here okay, let me show this what actually I'm talking about. Let me show over here. Now let me close this virtual user generator. See, as I said, it is preferable to open as administrator. Here, actually, we are talking about different protocols that are available here in Virtual User Generator, and there is something called single protocol and multiple protocol. It means while creating a script, basically it is going to show some options like single protocol and multiple protocol. While creating the script, basically here we technically call it as virtual user. The name of the script will be virtual user script. Okay, while creating the virtual user script, VUGEN shows basically two options. One is single protocol. It means say your application is purely web application. Okay, see in that case you are going to use a single protocol. It means you are going to select only one protocol. A multi-protocol means, say the application or the scenario that you are going to work, which is going to involve multiple type of application. Say for example, say you have a web application. Okay, you clicked on some link, or you clicked on something, and which is opened as some mainframe application. Just assume, say you have a web application. You perform some operation in the web application. Say it is open, it opened some SAP application, or it opened some mainframe application. And if you want to automate that particular scenario, okay, in that case you need to select this multi protocol over here. While creating the script, you need to select the multiple protocol over here. Okay, see, so let me show what actually I'm talking about here. Now see here, if you want to create a new script, probably you can go to this file menu. You can say new script and solution. Again, the solution concept, it has been newly introduced in 11.5. We'll discuss about that. Say, as of now, new script. Now see here, it is showing a single protocol option, a multiple protocol option. Can you see here, single protocol and multiple protocol? And based on the type of the scenario that you are going to automate, based on the type of the performance scenario that you are going to create a script over here, you are going to select. Say, if your scenario is going to interact with, SAP web and some HTTP protocol, in that case, probably you can go to this multiple protocol, and you are going to select the protocols that are required for the scenario. Say here, what actually I'm talking about? Say web, HTTP, HTML, and say here you wanted to select here. You know, as a selected web HTTP HTML protocol, there are some set of protocols has been disabled. It means those protocol, whatever the protocol that it has been disabled over here, those protocols are not compatible with this protocol that we have selected. Okay, we have selected web HTTP HTML protocol, right? Now, as we have selected this, there are some set of protocols has been disabled. It means those protocols are not compatible with this protocol. Okay, see here, say here, I want to do kind of you know, Oracle NCA. I mean Oracle NCA, it is basically it's for Oracle data, Oracle application. Even in Oracle also we'll have Oracle ERP applications. Okay, if you are planning to automate, if you are planning to find the performance of a Oracle ERP application, you are going to use Oracle NCA. Now see here, I have selected Oracle NCA, and here Web HTTP HTML protocol. Okay, say if your scenario is something like that, you can select multi protocol over here. In general, we will come across only single protocol, and I'm just showing over here. Okay, now let me go to single protocol here, and here in our class, basically we are going to work on this Web HTTP and HTML protocol. Okay, and probably you can even we can work on other protocols too. But as I said, most of the times we generally do the performance testing only for, I mean, mainly for the web-based applications. Okay. Now we'll try to take a web HTTP HTML protocol here. Now you can give it some name over here. Let me say sample. Let me say create. And even you can mention the location where exactly you want to create the scripts here. Probably we'll try to create the scripts in C driver. In C drive, we'll try to create some folder over here. VueGen scripts. Now it is going to create a sample script, a sample virtual user generator script under C drive virtual user generator scripts. Okay, so this is about protocols, different protocols. It means based on the type of the application, well, we are going to choose the protocols. Okay, and we have a single protocol. It means based on your type of application, based on the type of scenario that you are going to automate, you are going to choose the protocol. If you, if one of the scenario, it is going to interact with both, multiple type of applications like Oracle NCA and web application. In that case, probably you are going to select multiple protocol. And here, let me talk about one more feature here. Excuse me. Say for example, you have an application. Say application, and you will not be sure. What is the type of the protocol? I mean, what is the technology of the application that it is being built on? Say for example, so I'm your client. Say I gave one application to you, and say I'm asking you to automate, and I did not give any information for you. So you're not sure what is the type of application. You are not sure whether it is a Oracle ERP application. Are you not sure it's a SAP application? Say you don't know what is the type of the application. In that case, there is something called inspect protocol. There is an option like probably you can find somewhere. Under file, there should be actually searching because the 11.5 and the older version, this completely changed. It should be there. Yes, here there is an option called protocol advisor. Okay. By making use of this protocol advisor, you can conclude what is the type of the application. You can find out what is the type of the application that it has been. Okay, so here okay, there is something called protocol advisor. So this helps in helps in finding out the type of protocol for an application. I mean, say we have an application and we'll not be sure which type of protocol that we have to use. In that case, you can use this protocol advisor and you can decide what is the type of the protocol that you need to use. Okay, so this is available here under record menu, protocol advisor. In Loadrunner 11.5, and under record menu, protocol advisor. Okay, so generally you can find the information from the developers, but however, if you don't have any other resources, okay, in that case probably you can use a protocol advisor to find out the what is the type of the protocol that we have to use. Okay, now here let me move on here. Actions. Here actions means, see here, if you close the FDR, we have created a script called sample here. If you close the FDR, we have created a script name is called a sample. By default, if you close the FDR, there is something called actions and some extra files. Mainly, if you close the FDR, actions and some extra files. Okay, so here some runtime settings, parameters, some replay. We'll come back to these things. But first of all, if you look at here, by default, a Loadrunner script, a Loadrunner or virtual user script is going to contain three actions over here. By default, whenever you create a script over here, whenever you create a script here in the Loadrunner, it is going to contain three actions. Okay, here, one minute. We have been talking about the protocols, right? Let me take let us do one thing. Let me take a new sheet for this. Okay, whenever you create a virtual user script, by default it is going to contain three actions. Okay, by default it is going to contain three actions. One is vuser underscore init. Second one is action. And third one is vuser underscore end. Okay. And the main purpose of this vuser init, it is just a suggestion, it is not a mandatory rule, okay? It's just another provision only. It's just a provision. It is not a mandatory rule that you have to create like this, okay? Basically, by default, a virtual user script is going to contain, by default, three actions. Okay, before that, I know, let you know what is meant by action. Okay, do you know what is meant by actions? Action. What is meant by action? First of all, let us try to understand what is meant by an action. Yep. Now, probably if you know QTP or if you know... okay, fine. Is anyone here who don't know QTP here? Yep, fine. It's okay. Here, forget about that. Here, in simple, action means some set of steps for a particular task. And for those people who know QTP, in QTP we will be having actions, right? Here also the same thing. Here also whatever you have here, here also the same concept. Whatever you have in QTP, you have some kind of actions concept, right? It's also here also the similar concept. Okay, but by default, when you create a virtual user script, here we are going to have three actions. Rather than QTP, it is going to contain only one action by default. Okay, and here for each action has its own purpose over here. And it's just a provision, it is not a mandatory rule. Okay, and here one of the example for this action is something like, say, here, let me do one thing. Say for example, example for login, example for action will be like a login. So I'm simply saying login, but a login may contain some set of steps, right? Say it is something like, you know, here whenever I want to login, basically we wanted to open a browser, open the browser, okay, and then launch the URL, launch this www.amazon.com. And then say some click on login button, click on some login link, something, okay, and then enter username, enter password, okay, some click on sign button. So whenever we say here simply login, If I say simply login action, basically it is going to contain these steps. Okay, all these steps together we call it as a login. Okay, all these steps together we call it as a login. Okay, I'm simply calling it as a login action, but it's basically it is going to include these steps. Okay, together these steps will be called as a login. Okay, so in a similar way here by default. By default, when you create a virtual user script, it is going to contain three actions, and each action has its own purpose. Okay, has its own provision. See, basically the meaning of user underscore init is to maintain, is to keep the login logic. I mean login or launching of the application logic. Okay, login or some kind of init initialization kind of, you know, login. Launching an application, those kind of logic generally we are going to keep as part of usernet. Okay, is to keep the login or launching the application. Okay, and here in the action, in this action, it is to keep the actual logic. I mean actual business purpose. Say here you want to send an email. Say for example you are creating a Say for example you are creating a script for booking an order. Okay. Say here this user init may contain like opening a browser and opening this Amazon.com. And here as part of action it may contain searching for an item, and then it will go for the credit card section and it is going to check out. Okay. So this action is going to contain like actual business related logic. Okay, is to keep the actual business related functionality. And the user underscore init is to keep logout or closing application related part. Okay, and as I said, it's just a provision. You can have a customization. And you don't need to follow these things. Mainly the purpose is something like this. User init means here you are going to keep a kind of a launching and login, and action means actual business related logic. User underscore end. Here it is to keep the logout or closing application. And moreover, you can rename this action name. You can rename this action name. And moreover, you can add some more actions. Apart from these actions, user init, action and user end, you can create your own actions if you require. Okay. If you really require, you can create your own actions over here. Okay, and here you know again we don't have anything like reusable actions, non-reusable actions over here. Okay, we don't have any concepts like that. Okay, here I'm just saying, I was just trying to make you understand. It is similar to QTP, but in QTP you have something like reusable, non-reusable. Those kind of things will not be there here in LoadRunner, in virtual user generator. Okay, I've been talking about default actions. So default actions means these are the default actions, user init, action, and user underscore end. Okay, And if you close up here, say if I double click on this user init, say it is showing the user init, and this is going to be looks like. Generally, this user init, it's a kind of a function over here. User underscore init, and within brackets, and there is something called return 0. It is something like a function. And moreover, if you remember, I said in LoadRunner, we are going to use a C language. Okay? So basically, it is like a C language function. And probably we are going to discuss the basics of C also. You don't need to be expert in C. Okay? Basics is enough. Even I know you really don't require, you don't write much of C language over here. Okay? Basically, here we'll be understanding that we are going to use C language, but even we are not going to use much of C language. Okay? See, for user init, we have user underscore init. And for action, we have action action, and user underscore end, we have user underscore end over here. Okay, and by default, it's been directly, we did not have any action, does not contain any logic over here. Okay, because here we just created a sample virtual user script, that's it. Okay, now here, you can rename this particular action here. If you want to rename, just write it over here. You can say rename action. You can rename this particular action over here. Okay, say, let me say, search an item. Okay, you can rename it. What I mean, I think it is going to rename. See here. Okay, and not only rename, and moreover, you know, if you require, if you want to add one more action here, you can do that. Okay, say here I want to add one more action. Right click over here, and here under right click on the actions, and you can say that create new action. And here there is something called import action. It means import action means it is something you can copy and paste over here. Basically, you cannot make use of the existing action as I said earlier. Here in LoadRunner, we don't have a concept like reusable action, non-reusable action. If you want to make use of one action which is already created, probably you can use this import action here. Okay. So, however, if you want to create a new action, just right click on this actions, and there is something called create new action, and here you can give the action name. Let me say enter car details. Okay, so it has been such an item and enter car details, some kind of a sequence. It means not only the existing action. You can rename the existing action, and moreover, you can create some more actions over here. If you want to create a new action, right click on this actions. There will be create new action, or probably if you go to this design, there will be something like action, create new action. Okay, say here if you want to create a new action, LoadRunner 11.5 design menu action create action. Okay, so by using this you can create an action out here, create new action, and here they can give the action name over here. Okay, now we go here, default actions and create new actions. Yep, alright. Now we'll continue with this recordings. We have been trying to understand these protocols and actions. Okay, now we'll try to continue with this recording. So here, in general, in advanced QTP classes, okay, I mean, in general, QTP, I mean, for functional automation testing, whatever the LoadRunner is basically for the performance automation testing, it is for the performance tool, okay. However, generally, this one, in QTP, basically recording is not preferable. Okay, in QTP, recording is not preferable. In real time, basically a QTP automation tester will not use recording. Okay, in QTP, recording is not preferable, which is not in real time. Generally, we are not going to use a recording option in QTP. Whereas in LoadRunner, we have to use the recording. Otherwise, it will be hard to develop the scripts. Okay. Here in LoadRunner, we have to use recording. Otherwise, it will be hard to develop the scripts. Okay. Now see here. Let me take a new script here. Again, let me start HTTP, and here let me say my fast script. Now there are. Let me close all these things which are related to the previous one. And if you close it up here, we can open multiple scripts at a time here in LoadRunner. Okay. Whereas in QTP, we cannot open multiple scripts at a time. However, here currently we are going to work on with my first script. Okay. Again, by default, it is showing this user init, action, and user end. Okay. If you want to record something here, and as I said, here in LoadRunner, we have to use recording. Without recording, it will be harder to develop the script. Okay. Now, here we are going to use this recording option. And moreover, if you remember, here, in the protocol section, in the protocol topic here, I said there will be communication between this browser and this server, right? In general, there will be communication between the client and server. Okay. Here in the LoadRunner, and particularly in the VoE generator, whenever you say recording, it is going to record the communication between this client and server. It is basically going to record the communication between the client and server. I mean, what is the what client is sending? I mean, what is the request is being sending to the server? What is the response is getting from the server? Okay, those kind of conversation will be monitored and it is going to be recorded as part of a script. Okay, I think you are getting what I'm saying. It is basically a client and server here. Generally, LoadRunner here in virtual user generator, it is going to record the communication between the client and server. Okay, whatever client is requesting and whatever the server is responding, those communication will be recorded as part of virtual user script. That is the reason I'm saying here we have to use recording. Without recording, if you try to write the logic without recording, we will not show what the client is sending. Okay, client is going to send the request in one of the format, and server is going to send the response in one format, and we will not be sure what actually client is sending, what server is going to send. So that is the reason we cannot write the script without recording. We have to use the recording because there is some communication is happening between the client and server. Okay. Now see here, if you want to record, probably you can go to the record now, and there is a record option. Or here, if you see here a red color round button, just by clicking on this also you can record. Okay. Now here, when you click on this record option, this is going to show a recording some options over here. Okay. Now see here, record into action. Here, if you see here, by default we have three actions, right? User init, action, and user end. So here you have three actions. So to which action you want to record? I mean, what are the things that you are going to record? Whatever it is going to be recorded, to which action you want to record? By default, it is being shown as action. It is preferable to select user init. As I said, generally opening the applications, logging to the application, generally it is going to be recorded as part of user init. Okay. So in general, whenever we are going to open the application, it might be open application, it might be login. So generally, we are going to record as part of user underscore init action. Okay, what is the application type that you are going to record? Is it a web application? Is it going to be Windows? If you remember, we have selected HTTP HTML protocol. Okay, here I'm selecting web. and here application to record. Under which type of application you want to record? Here I want to record on Internet Explorer. That is the reason I'm selected Internet Explorer. And what is the type of application that you are going to record? Say you want to record on Google, or you want to record on eBay, or you want to record on Amazon. Under which under which application you are.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.